7 Perth, celebrating 50 years of television.
50 years is a long time in any business. But in television, it's a lifetime. It's a lifetime because that's how long it's been since TVW Perth first went to air. That night back in 1959, when Sir James Crothers famously opened TVW for broadcast. It's been a very proud history with people who have been innovative, dedicated and committed to bringing to Western Australia the best available television, the best available technology, and certainly brought a unique feeling to the community of Western Australia. Tonight we honour those memories and we honour those people who have made this contribution along the way. We hope you enjoy the snapshots that we have, and we hope that you will take pleasure in reliving those moments which have been so historic in our state.
In a few moments, you will see the first live pictures transmitted from the studios of TVW Channel 7. You're about to take part in an historic occasion, and the curtain is about to rise on a new era in entertainment and a new way of life in Western Australia. This is a moment you and I will not experience again.
This is a wonderful day.
Fifty years ago, on this very night, a single moment altered forever the way we watch the world. With the flick of a switch, in the blink of an eye, a moment in our past transformed our future.
Time and technology have made great advances.
Great new era of entertainment.
The state's first official television.
It was the moment TVW Channel 7 Perth proudly became Western Australia's first television station.
It all began with an application. An application to the Australian Broadcasting Control Board for a license to operate a television station in Perth.
My boss was Jim McCartney, and he called me up one day and said, okay, got the license, got to start a television station. Please start it a year from today. Thank you. There wasn't a person in Western Australia who knew anything about television whatever. I don't think most of them had even seen television.
As the studios were being built, the builders were fighting their way through snakes and all sorts of other wildlife. And even after we opened, Harry Butler used to actually catch snakes in the backyard at Channel 7.
Auditions started for announcers, newsreaders, entertainers of all descriptions. They came in their hundreds from all corners of the state, all hopeful of finding their place in this new medium of entertainment.
Quite frankly, you know, how it ever got together, you wouldn't know.
In the studio, the large television cameras were checked, cameramen were trained, entertainers rehearsed, and the interminable equipment test went on.
I don't think we realise just how powerful television would end up being.
It's getting close now. Soon, all will be ready.
And we were all very happy and proud that we were doing it for WA.
Stand by on the floor. 15 seconds. Focus up, camera two.
We want to make it a people's channel. The channel should belong to the people.
Dissolved to two.
Good evening, I'm Yvette Mooney.
And I'm Simon Reeve, and welcome to Channel 7's celebration of our first incredible 50 years.
You know, Simon, it was in these studios on this very night, 50 years ago, that we went to air for the first time.
Can you believe it, Yvette? It's gone like that.
It's just whizzed by, hasn't it? When did you start at Channel 7 Perth, Simon?
Well, I was employed by Sir James Crothers, Yvette, back in 1979.
That long ago.
And you?
I wasn't far behind you, 1984.
Very good. It's great to have you back.
Thank you very much, and it's great to be here. here for this special occasion. Back then, it was a time when a man called Robert Menzies was the Prime Minister, a former Dongara boy, David Brand, the Premier, and Sir Charles Gardner, our Governor. We drove mostly Holden cars, costing around £800, and filled the tanks with shillings. But we didn't drive on the Narrows. That was still being built.
Now, can you believe it, Yvette? Even though only about 3,000 television sets had been sold, it's estimated that 70,000 viewers watched those first nervous moments from outside shop windows on a cold October night or in hamburger bars, wherever they could find a television.
It must have been so exciting. And tonight you'll hear names you remember, see faces you recall. Some have come and gone. Many are still with us. And Simon, tonight we'll salute them all as we celebrate our first 50 years.
On October 16, 1959, Channel 7 was responsible for bringing television to Perth for the very first time.
Many important civic, religious and business leaders arrived for the opening.
It was one of the most anticipated events in Perth.
They were greeted by station executives.
For weeks leading up to the opening, there'd been a great deal of newspaper publicity and radio publicity.
Now all is ready. All departments alerted.
We were all clamouring around the one person in the street that might have had a TV.
In city streets, there was a mild attack of television fever as crowds gathered around shop windows.
People lining up outside electrical shops watching the one television in the storefront.
I can remember watching the test pattern waiting for something to happen. And then people said later on, your shows are a bit like that too.
It was live, it was hairy, there were mistakes.
Everything that happened went on those cameras. Wrong, right or indifferent.
And His Excellency alive.
The Governor, Sir Charles Gardner, he arrived by Rolls Royce and drove into the tiny little studio.
On behalf of all of us here at TVW Channel 7, I'm very pleased, and I must admit just a little bit relieved, to be able to say at long last, welcome to television in Western Australia.
I can remember it clearly because at one stage a metal cap fell off the camera and clanked onto the floor.
Our overseas programs include some of the favourites of world television. For adventure, we've selected Sea Hunt, the story of a skin diver.
And stopped everything, nearly stopped me, but we kept going. Clank, 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 clank.
Tonight is a very important one in the history of our state. It was certainly another milestone to progress, and it is bound to affect, profoundly affect, the lives of the majority of us.
It was a major thing for Perth. Suddenly they were in touch with the rest of the world, where really it had only been radio beforehand.
And of course, the opening night of Channel 7's news. Looking back on it now, it seems very rinky-dink, but it was fantastic at the time. It was a total new world.
Before that, the only news, of course, was the newsreels you used to see at the cinema, at the movies, when you went to the Saturday matinees.
We ran two live news bulletins, the first ever news bulletins to be seen live in Western Australia.
At Mandurah, a grim and painstaking operation to try to rescue 2.5-year-old Graham Davies. The boy is trapped 25 feet below the surface in a small 18-inch borehole.
In those days, getting news was very difficult. You had two old radios in the car, but very little. You couldn't monitor police radio. That was against the law. And we were a long way out here at Tewart Hill. I used to instruct the cameraman to listen to the radio, listen to the six-hour cricket broadcast. If they heard a fire engine siren or an ambulance horn, they'd chase it. On the opening night, the general manager, Jim Crothers, put a memo on the board saying good luck. Now, it was a great night and we did have good luck. We got through very clearly and it was just an exciting opening night. But the next night, it was a different story. On day two of television in Western Australia, everyone came to work full of delight that they'd conquered television. There'd been a party after the opening in the studios here to celebrate 3 or 4 months of intensive work, and our cinema photographers and the editors went up to the Charles Hotel. The only problem was they didn't come back, and with 1.5 hours yet to go before the news, we didn't have any film, we didn't have anything in fact. I told John, don't roll the opening of the news because we haven't got a news. And John, of course, rolled the news opening and dissolved down to the news desk. Of course, there was no newsreader. It was a total disaster.
Well, we've come a long way since day two, and you only make one mistake like that, or at least admit to it.
Exactly, and in the months before we went to air, Seven auditioned hundreds of TV hopefuls, actors, rope spinners, even performing dogs, to create an era of trademark 60s television.
And because TV was so new back then, there were very few rules and so much fun.
It was exciting. There were new frontiers to be breached.
I am Martin St. James.
We could just do anything.
There were many events which were quite historic.
Senator Kennedy has been shot.
Perth changed dramatically in the 60s. Up until Eric Edgar Cook and the mass killings, Perth was a free city.
Perth, city on the swan. Charm and glamour mark it distinctive of the capital of Western Australia.
Very quiet place. People still getting around in their pinstripe double-breasted suits in the middle of summer.
Some of you have remarked about the ladies' hats and their dresses. I wonder what they'll say in 50 years' time when they look back at these pictures.
All of a sudden, Perth literally became a city of terror.
A mystery gunman shot two people dead in Vincent and Louise Streets, Nedlands.
I don't think we've seen the city before or since gripped in such a way.
A third man was critically wounded and the gunman fired upon two other people sitting in a parked car.
I think it was a fear born of utter helplessness because people just didn't know where this killer was.
The gunman vanished into the night as mysteriously as he had arrived. He left few clues.
I know of stories of people actually crawling to the door and peeking out through the window. It was genuinely a very, very frightening period.
We capture the desperation.
Technology has made great advances.
Holocaust, inferno, fireball. Who can adequately describe the scene here dwelling up today?
Cinders being fired 500 metres ahead of the fire, and the town was totally devastated.
Stories to be told here today and dwelling up are varied and sad and shocking.
We looked out and we could see the flames leaping right around.
Most of them lost everything. There was just a shell of a town.
It shall be the policy of this day.
Think that although you poor simple people have been voting for me for 15 years...
Robert Menzies was one of the world's great orators.
You've been voting for an utter fraud.
There were always people prepared to interject at Menzies, but they did it at their own risk.
Chap down here, clever fella, very clever chap. And who caused all this trouble with Malaysia and Indonesia? I said, well, I suppose I did. My name must be Sukarno.
In the Busselton area, fallen rivers broke their banks to extend them.
One of the most significant events that took place in Perth was the demolishing of the barracks.
The wave of controversy and the storm of protest.
There was a public outcry, and I mean, there were protest marches.
State cabinet seemed bent on demolition.
It happened, and WA's the poorer for it.
My guess, Simon, that would probably never happen today.
Just amazing, really.
It was. But among the news that made headlines on Seven in the 60s, we had a lot of laughs as well.
We might not have realised it back then, but Channel 7 was producing its own early version of reality TV.
As a result, we were spellbound.
I am Martin St. James, and with the help of some volunteers from our studio audience, I intend to show you tonight how, when the human mind is uninhibited, anything can happen.
presenting Martin St. James with Spellbound.
It was exciting. There were new frontiers to be breached. There was no worry about what would happen if we did this. We could just do anything.
When I count to three, you will all try hard to open your eyes.
And we did. Amazing. Chaotic. But when we edited it all together, we had a program. We discovered two characters.
We have here two gentlemen who we actually believe are from the moon.
These people were supposedly hypnotized and they spoke in a different language.
Would you ask him what he come down to Earth for?
But only his friend could understand what he was saying.
What did he say?
He's a male.
The program was sold to the Eastern States, and I think, from memory, it was banned in Victoria.
The moment you get back in the audience, you'll think you're a ladies' underwear salesman.
They thought that maybe the people who are watching could indeed become hypnotized.
Sadly, the last day of our current trip to the West.
Shipwrecks of the early days and the adventure. This is Sounds Alive.
Stars of the Future was just an amazing program.
Just take my hand and come along with me.
Girls and boys who had any musical talent at all would come along and do their stuff.
It was really ahead of its time because we would have all these children involved in choreographed performances.
Carly Condon and Max Kay were the judges.
I think if you can lose your inhibitions and really let your voice go, you've got a very bright future indeed. Thank you very much.
There was some wonderful talent that went through and it sort of built up during the year to a grand final.
The grand final is only about 6 weeks away and the prizes to be won are great. There's an HMV portable television set valued at $199. I loved it. It was an amazing experience. I got to sing a little bit.
It was a really popular show. We won a Logie for it. But then Johnny Young came along and he nicked it. Is he here?
Who's on the program, by the way? We've got the Strangers, of course.
Club 17 provided me not only with my start in television, but it also provided me with my start in the music business.
It was an incredible program. I mean, some of the guests we had on that program were of international standing.
The Dave Clark Five, Bob Dylan, Peter, Paul and Mary, Normie Rowe and the Playboys, the Easy Beats.
Any pop star that came to town went on that show.
Wow, how incredible. My band did all the music and the joint was rocking, going round and round.
It was the Tom's TV Showdown.
We'll tell you about it.
I'll be back next Wednesday, not looking like Bette Davis, I hope.
Bands of Perth and Fremantle, the fastest growing stars of the West, present Reach for the Stars. And now, meet Jeff Newman.
Well, Reach for the Stars was a comedy quiz show, which involved contestants doing silly things.
Both hands and making a noise like a car, drive it around the marker.
And answering almost sane questions.
It's worth 14 points. What is the national drink of Russia? Vodka is right, yes.
The contestants were racing against the clock all the time.
When they do, they run down to our star wheel like this and give it a spin. There we are. That's the first spin of the evening.
Stuart Wagstaff came over as a special guest.
Oh, he's marvellous, isn't he? Brilliant. Bring another star back. It's a stunt worth 16 points. Here is Teenie, our stunt girl. I want you to do a stunt with her. Yes. Quickly, off you go. Do a stunt with her.
But it turned out to be a winner, and it was a great show.
Jeff Newman, Gary Carvalth, great to have you with us. So much came out of these studios, didn't it? I mean, it was prolific back then. For a little place on the edge of the earth, this was, like I say, it was like Broadway.
The weekends here were absolutely amazing. You'd have dancing girls, you'd have musos, you'd have everybody coming in. We'd have a children's show, we'd do a talent show, we'd do It's Academic, we'd have a football show on a Sunday morning. Everything used to happen right here in the studio.
Well, people find it hard to believe. I think these days there's approximately 80 on the staff. In its heyday, there was close to 500.
Amazing.
You know. Huge.
The worst thing is I can never get people to call me Mr. Reeve on It's Academic. I don't know what it is. It's a sign of the times. They'll call me Simon these days. So, but back then, it was always Mr. Newman, wasn't it?
Yes, Mr. Newman, number 13,
it's Mr. Newman. Whatever. He used to insist upon it.
Indeed. Well, Mr. Newman, Mr. Carvalth, it's been great chatting with you. Thanks so much for coming in.
Thanks, Simon.
And we'll be back after the break with the boy from Bassendean, the man who gave us the wobble board from these very studios.
Strolling in the nap time, kangaroo down.
Time, kangaroo down. Time, kangaroo down.
The countdown begins at Cape Canaveral, Florida, for one of man's greatest adventures.
Kennedy had announced that the Americans would put a man in space within the decade.
This nation should commit itself to achieving the goal before this decade is out of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the earth.
It's a scientific wonder. It was Buck Rogers and Star Trek all rolled into one.
Friendship 7, this is Mujer Comtech. Do read, over.
Hello, Mujer Comtech.
And on the occasion when John Glenn was going to girdle the Earth,
Godspeed, John Glenn.
We had Gordon Cooper, the astronaut, at Mucha as the command communicator. Now, Brian Treasure said, why don't you ask Cooper if Glenn can see the lights of Perth? I asked Cooper that at the press conference, and he said, yeah, he'll be able to see the lights of Perth, but it's not particularly important.
I can see the outline of a town and a very bright light just to the south of it.
Hey, Roger, that's Perth and Rockingham, you're saying there.
And ultimately, the city decided to, big deal, switch on every light.
Roger, the lights show up very well, and thank everybody for turning them on, will you?
It really did put WA on the map.
Liftoff, we have a liftoff.
The world was awaiting this moon flight. Everyone was really glued to their television sets.
And we're getting a picture on the TV.
Perth stopped. The whole town stopped stone dead.
I'm going to step off the limb now.
It just was a stunning historic event.
It's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
That was the event which Perth will never ever forget.
I have to report there is no rule.
Charles Manson is your brother.
People ran screaming into the streets.
When the earthquake struck, it cut off all the communications. We were totally isolated.
And at that moment, I saw the chimney falling off the house.
Until yesterday, Meckering was almost unknown outside Western Australia. Now, after 40 seconds of natural torment, Meckering is a household word.
It also affected Perth, and there was a great deal of debris falling onto the St. George's Terrace, and the whole building here at Channel 7 was shaking. Had it gone another 30 seconds, it may have shaken Perth down. If it happens again, God help us.
Hello, Australia. 18 or 19 years in Lake
Worth. Cyclones on record.
For sheer shock, however, I think the Kennedy assassination topped them all.
That was one of probably the only two or three times I've ever seen people cry in the street.
John F. Kennedy died at approximately 1 o'clock.
John F. Kennedy was the Western hero.
He was a remarkable man.
Absolutely captivated the world.
Ask not what your country can do for you. Ask what you can do for your country.
Even now, everybody can remember exactly where they were the day JFK died.
Ah, and in those moments, we saw for the first time televisions to unite an audience, to deliver history happening. The power of TV was emerging. Suddenly, we could witness events changing lives and connect with personalities, the way TV connected us to the charismatic Kennedys. Few would argue TV helped JFK touch the world.
Because of this medium, Yvette, the world was suddenly a stage, the perfect platform for a local boy, Rolf Harris, who had just returned from England to work on Children's Channel 7, earning the princely sum of £40 a week.
Not bad back then. This is his first recording. The demo is scratchy, it's rough, but a TV treasure.
The song, like the performer, has become part of Aussie folklore. Rolf at his famous tiny kangaroo down sport, recorded right here in the Channel 7 studios nearly 50 years ago.
Tiny kangaroo down sport, tiny kangaroo down, tiny kangaroo down sport, tiny kangaroo down.
I had written the song in England, and when we got out to Australia, we got the Rhythm Spinners, who were a local singing group, guitars and close harmony, and we all stood around underneath a microphone, a single microphone, and I did the song with the wobble board, and then the bass came,
there's an old Australian stockman lying, dying, and he gets himself up onto one elbow and he turns to his mates who are gathered around and he says, all together now, tiny kangaroo down sport,
tiny kangaroo. And I stopped on the recording because the three rhythm spinners were singing, tama kangaroo down sport, tama kangaroo down. I stopped and said, what are you doing? They said, oh, well, you've got to have an American accent or you never sell any records unless you got an American act. I said, look, it's my blooming song. Just sing the way you speak. Don't put on any phony accent.
Watch me wallabies feed, mate. Watch me wallabies feed. They're a dangerous breed, mate. So watch me wallabies feed. All together now.
At the end of the recording, I said to the guys, I mean, I was so green, I didn't know a thing about music, and it was my first ever record, and I said, do you want 10% of the royalties? 10% of the royalties? Or would you like a recording fee? And without exception, the three guys and the bass player said, we'll take a recording fee, thanks very much, because they had so little confidence in the song. The song went to number one in about 4 weeks, Australia-wide. It was a huge hit.
We've got some fantastic shows lined up.
Oh, yeah, Rolls Royce.
Oh, the winner is Stephanie Quinlan.
In Perth Tonight.
You look like a walking advertisement for Air India.
You're like a tip. Hey, where are we anyway?
Studio One at TVW.
We used to use a lot of the personalities on the station from time to time as cross promotion and bring them into the program. People loved it. They loved to see their personalities in another role.
Tonight, Mavis goes national.
Mavis Bramston was coming to town. Well, I don't think the town would ever be the same again.
How was the welcome?
Darlings, it was absolutely fabulous. It was really divine.
We thought there'd be a crowd. We had no idea of just how large that crowd would be. It was absolutely incredible.
Look at them rolling out the red carpet.
The red carpet just
aren't
for
they
you.
Sweet? They're the counsellors.
She knocked them dead, and she came on in Perth Tonight and did the same thing wherever she went.
Welcome to the Today Show.
As they play Family Feud.
Thank you, good evening, and welcome back.
This is LWA at its best. It's so peaceful.
Oh,
The fish are very friendly.
The thing about RWA for me was that I wanted, essentially as the storytellers, people who were writers. So I had Max and I had Ross Dunkerton and I had Sue John and I had Paula and I had Mandy Walsh and I had Paul Redman.
Got my guitar, got my rods, let's go to X-Men.
I had these people who were storytellers, whether they had a story to tell or not, and then sent them off into the wilds of Western Australia.
Check out this bloke. It's the biggest rock in the world, known as Mount Augustus.
Welcome to Anything Goes.
Best of your place or mine.
Can't believe I'm hearing
this. Hello, audience.
Hi, everyone. Welcome to the program.
When you were younger, did you have friends? The only one you ever owned.
Her real strength is she's a very much a people person.
You're looking terrific. Hi.
She laughs a lot.
Oh, my God. Have a look at that.
She would say things which, there were a lot of tautologies with Jenny.
I'm going home to play with that.
I can see that. You've been playing with it all night, haven't you? I'd hang off a cliff for that.
Would you?
I'd hang off anything for that.
She would mangle the English language.
I'm a singer.
Yeah.
No, I'm not an actor. If you've ever seen me act, you'll understand.
I thought you did very well as JC had me convinced. I nearly flatulated. Yeah. Is that a wash? That's not the word.
And you flip.
But the good thing was, as a producer, I went, well, I've got half a show here, you know, just because she'd made a complete bollocks of it.
No wonder I'm asked to leave parties.
Jen, wonderful stuff. And your flatulence is okay these days, dear?
All under control, thank you very much. Women don't do that sort of thing, by the way. And Keith Geary, I'm after him. He used to give me
mangled
a hard
English
time.
Language. How dare he?
But we had the right of way to do that because we were lucky enough to do live television and you went with the flow.
Wonderful days and wonderful memories, yeah?
Look, I still laugh and laugh and laugh about so many of the fantastic things that we did. Jimmy Chadwick one time was put into Fat Cat's big red armchair.
I'd like you to be serious in a minute.
I'm trying to be.
Jimmy Chadwick, as you know, is the funniest man who doesn't crack it for a smile. He's so serious.
What went wrong? That's a football match.
You're crying, Jimmy.
Couldn't speak. I could not speak for the next 5 minutes. I just absolutely ached. I thought, I'm going to lose my job here.
Next week, we've got financial advice, Peter Gilkinson.
I don't do it all the time. I don't giggle all the time.
My sincere apologies. I have never lost control like this before in my entire life.
No, no. I'm holding up pretty well.
We've got to go. Have a wonderful weekend.
Oh, dear. You're crying again. Oh, it's
look,
wonderful.
I spent half my life, I think, on camera with tears running down my face, mascara being smudged everywhere.
Jen, it's been great chatting with you.
Thank you so much
for coming in.
Thank you.
Now, after the break, the gang who created Channel 7's unforgettable era of kids' television.
I had the job of chief masketeer.
Children's Channel 7.
Probably my favourite thing that I did.
I shall resign the presidency.
The early 70s was just dominated by one harrowing traumatic event called Vietnam.
The Vietnam War brought war into our lounge rooms for the first time.
We were witnessing too the reaction to these events.
Protest rallies against the war were being held all over the Western world.
Are simply agents of the Soviet government operating on their behalf.
We'll never ever forget the horror of Vietnam.
Elvis Presley died today.
In Forest Place we had a major protest against Gough Whitlam. A great number of rowdy farmers came into Forest Place and they gave him hell. Probably was the turning point in having all political rallies removed from that area.
When he appears,
you will give him the reception he deserves.
The Gough Whitman dismissal was one of those events like, where were you when you heard about it?
Well, may we say, God save the Queen.
It was a fascinating time in politics.
Because nothing will save the Governor-General.
See the full extent of the disaster.
This city of Perth is in the front line of the South African tour.
The Springbok tour was a major international event.
The city of Australia itself has been split into two parties, which are set head on.
The pilots threatened to go on strike and wouldn't fly them. Hotel staff around Australia threatened to go on strike.
The Swan Brewery Employees Union announced today that it had placed a black ban on the supply of beer.
That tour brought it home to Australians what apartheid was all about.
Two or three of the Springbok rugby players have emerged from the customs office.
It was a tour that should never, ever have happened.
Cyclone Tracy struck down.
Somewhere out there beyond the limits of the Earth's atmosphere, a massive US space station was in the death throes.
Skylab wasn't going to land in WA, but it did. All the experts said no, wasn't going to land here, but it did.
We felt as though we could almost feel the wind of it. We were ready to duck for cover.
And I remember the race was on to find bits of Skylab all over the countryside because there was money on offer for the biggest bit.
But the finder's plans to head for San Francisco and the $10,000 reward gradually evaporated. Their prize, later identified as an oxygen cylinder, was impounded by the police. They declared it lost property.
Okay, no guessing where we're at now.
It's Percy and Fat Cat. Hello, it's way past your bedtime. Come over here.
Percy and Fat Cat, or should I say, Francis Aloysius Tomcat, two of our all-time favourites.
And here are a few more. It's the best show in town. People come from all around to the place where fun people meet. Hey, it's the best show in town. Wear a smile and not a frown. Join the fun and get with the beat. Hey, hey, there's Fat Cat and Sandy and Margo's just dandy with shots.
And flick, off goes Crusader Rabbit.
I'd like to introduce myself before you have a look at this next bit. I'm Rolf Harris, and the little story you're going to see is a story about Oliver Polyp, the nice old octopus.
I used to talk directly to people at home through the screen, and I used to imagine that I could see them there and believe that they were there.
You remember last week, Oliver was out painting. Let's draw Oliver, busy with his paintbrush and his easel.
Okay, there's his head and eyebrows and his eyes and his little smile like that.
That's his first leg. Oh, you should be counting the legs with me. That's one. Wait a week.
I would get people at home to actually count the legs.
One, two.
Somebody's not counting there. One, two, we've had, come on.
Three legs to go. Six, we've got to stand on something. Six, and seven, and eight, one in there.
That's the charming little Oliver Polyp the octopus.
I had the job of chief masketeer. I, in my Mickey Mouse ears and a yellow t-shirt with Carolyn written across the front.
Forever let us hold our banner high, 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 high.
Every week we would have interviewed about 100 kids. Such an amazing chance for mums and dads and grannies and grandpas and aunts and uncles to see their kids on television. It was very popular.
Look at that.
Early Birds was probably my favourite thing that I did.
And he's got a big blue tie and green pants. That's different.
It was live, so any mistakes were live to air.
And you haven't got any pants on.
It was kind of terrifying as well because if things went wrong, and they invariably did...
Hold it, hold it, hold it.
We just had to learn how to deal with it and move on.
Listen, what's wrong?
Percy decided that he'd play a little bit of a trick on me. he was trying to tell me that he needed to leave and go to the toilet.
You want to hurry? Oh, can I ask why?
I thought, oh, he's going to stop in a minute and, you know, we can keep going. But he didn't. He just kept going with it.
Anyway, our first space chase is from Sandra Gregory.
Wherever I go, I know he goes. Wherever I go, I know he goes.
Fat cat. He had no fear at all.
I want to be just like Indiana.
He would just do anything. If I said to him, mate, this is going to be okay, go fine, and he'd do it.
You're not scared of doing this, it's too late.
No.
He's a bit of a daredevil.
He is.
So we take him down there paragliding. And the idea was at the end, he would come in and land on the riverbank with me and Sharon, right? And he comes in, but he's got size 29 feet. And the toes catch, whoomba, straight in the river. We've gone, oh no, don't drown the cat. But he just filled up. He's like a big sponge.
It's Children's Channel 7. And it's great to have you here.
Okay, you all ready?
That's when it happened.
Everyone today's taking home some fantastic things. They must be the luckiest family in the metropolitan area.
There he is. Say hello, Oliver.
I had a super time. I mean, it was probably the best year of my life.
That was Children's Channel 7.
Now, that jingle brings back so many memories, and it is wonderful to have Carolyn, Sandy and Trina with us today. And also, Rolf actually wrote the Children's Channel 7 jingle. Now, Carolyn, tell us about the Mouseketeers.
Well, they are wonderful memories, Simon. They had 25,000 kids to start with in that little club, and it grew to 35,000, and
wow.
Everybody received a badge and eventually an invitation to come into Channel 7, appear on television, where I spoke to them about pets and mum and dad and friends and school, and they all loved it, and their mums and dads loved it even more.
Fantastic.
And Trina, you and Percy were great mates. How did you first meet?
Well, I went into the studio one day. There was a great big crate that said, quarantine for 5 days, but feed fish. And I did so, and on the fifth day, we opened the crate, and that began a love affair between Percy Penguin and the children of Western Australia.
Trina, okay, enough about Percy. Sandy, tell us about Fat Cat.
Well, we had lots of great times as well. And in fact, it was Percy that held a competition on Children's Channel 7 to find Perth's largest cat. We had kids coming in with these huge cats into the studio, and eventually Percy introduced his cat, the biggest cat in Perth.
How
and
fantastic.
There we have Fat Cat.
Wonderful. Or Percy, you've got a problem. Uh-oh. It's happening again, Sandy. Percy's got to go, and we've got to go. We'll see you after the break.
It was live to the entire world.
Miss Venezuela is Miss
Tonight, the startling new evidence that could blow the lid on the Perth mint swindle.
There's very few local stories that have dominated the headlines for three decades.
On June 22nd, 2,185 ounces of gold simply disappeared.
It encompassed the theft of the gold from the Perth mint.
Although no gold had been found, Ray, Peter and Brian were convicted in March 1983.
Police fabrication of evidence.
I've disgraced the good members of the WA police force.
It's undermined the justice system in a lot of ways.
I've always known I was innocent of these crimes.
It's just got every element of a major television story.
A 20-ounce gold bar missing from the Perth mint swindle was today received in the mail by Seven Nightly News reporter Alison Fan.
Then, just 3 months later, I got another letter saying, go down to the entrance of Channel 7, have a look at two oil containers. Inside those oil containers was $1 million worth of gold pellets. They looked like cornflakes. Who would send back $1 million worth of gold? Nobody knows. Nobody can say to this day.
I just yelled out, has anyone got a torch? The dingo's got my baby.
The tanks rolled out of the square.
Barlow and Chambers have been brought back here to Pinjarra Prison in Penang, where they've been held since they were arrested at the airport 21 months ago.
Gosh, the Barlow and Chambers story was such an eye-opener to us all as to what could happen to people in foreign countries.
Whether or not they are guilty of trafficking in 180 grams of heroin now seems irrelevant.
It was a political hot potato because all of a sudden you've got two Australians being sentenced to death
What is real is the short walk tomorrow morning at dawn from their tiny prison cell on death row to where Pudu Prison's hangman will be waiting.
They were going to hang. There was no question.
The execution took place just now, and the bodies have been sent to the mortuary.
The case of the Burnies is also an enduring memory for a lot of people in Perth.
This was a time when nobody had an inkling that serial killers were on the loose.
The gruesome details of the state's worst mass murder emerged when 35-year-old David Burney admitted killing the four women and abducting and sexually assaulting a 16-year-old girl who escaped.
Police constantly denied it. In fact, they even came out and accused me and Channel 7 of being irresponsible for running stories that a serial killer could be around when these girls were going missing.
The tightest security seen in years surrounded the old courthouse here in Fremantle this morning.
We've never seen scenes like this in a court before. It was almost a lynch mob mentality.
Bloody mongrel bastard.
If I was inside there, I'd kill you.
The crowd were outraged. Here were four girls brutally murdered and tortured. Cold-blooded killers.
Alison Fan there, making news herself in some cases. Well, this extraordinary technology called television just kept on evolving. And in March 1975, Channel 7 switched to colour.
It sure did. It changed the way we viewed TV and the way we made it.
1975 is going to be a very, very important year for television right throughout Australia. It's going to be more important for you people too, because you're going to see colour television for the first time.
Well, so much had been said about this new medium called colour television. It was momentous. We had this big tower built in the studio here, and we invited the then Premier, Sir Charles Court, to come in and turn on the colour. We had this big switch, and he pulled it down then. Magically, everything was in colour. It was an exciting new age. And everyone went overboard with colours.
We're going to show you what some of the programmes look like in colour that you're seeing now.
Our children's programme sets were all of a sudden really bright and colourful.
Right, Perth, we finally made it. And hi to all the girls and boys out there. And we're finally here in living colour.
People in colour. Programmes in colour.
Cute. I'm green on Seven's Colour Machine, The Muppet Show.
I'm brown, so what?
I can remember its academic set being pretty well subdued, and all of a sudden we had bright green and bright yellow.
OK, Morley, ready for the questions?
Yes.
Good, Tony, would you select the packet, please?
Number three, please, Miss Newman.
One day I'm standing there and a little boy said to his mum, there's Trina, and she's all coloured in. There are new and exciting things to see
in the world of television. It was a brand new thing all over again, television rediscovered.
Now, you're wondering why colour was minus the U at the end there?
I was wondering.
OK, well, in the 70s, our special effects were all done in America. But something we did do very well here was entertain.
Indeed. Colour coincided with a bright new world for all of us. We launched the Perth Entertainment Centre, which at the time was the biggest purpose-built theatre of its kind in the world. It even made the Guinness Book of Records.
How about that? Opened in 1974, it took Perth to the world. In 1979, Miss Universe was watched live by an estimated 700 million people around the planet.
Oh, it was massive. Seven was all things entertainment. We even swept the premier of the day off his feet.
Ladies and gentlemen and boys and girls, this is a wonderful day for the city of Perth.
Welcome to this live colour telecast of the official opening of the Channel 7 Edgeley Entertainment Centre.
Here I am, Bob, here in Perth to bring you mirth, hope.
Live from the new heart of Perth, welcome to the official opening celebrations of Cinema City.
The biggest live show to ever come to Australia.
We want Mickey.
We want Mickey.
Hey,
Good.
Ladies and gentlemen, we give you the Andrew Sisters to sing In the Mood.
We told our friends here in Perth that we like to get out and see the country.
June, you want some kangaroo tail?
Tonight's direct from the Perth Concert Hall.
Plenty of laughs, plenty of games, lots of songs, and of course, lots of pretty girls.
Miss Western Australia 1968 is Miss Yvonne Johnson.
Christine Anderson of Sorrento.
Karen Lynn Gregory.
Francine Moretz of Victoria Park.
Jay Hopewell from Western Australia.
Number 4, Stephanie Adler.
Miss Western Australia 1984 is Leslie Cock.
Miss Randy Baker.
Number 3, Karen Peeney.
I want to go back to WA. Back to WA. That's the only place for me.
Miss Universe, we were so excited about that because, I mean, that was big time, serious overseas stuff.
It was live to the entire world, or the known universe as it was called at that time.
First runner up is Miss Bermuda. Miss Venezuela is Miss Universe.
And of course, there was the awful, awful stage collapse.
And it just went kwomph, and there was a big sort of hole full of pretty young girls. You know, it's like, oh, what do we do now? You know, drag them out, I suppose. You know, oh, hello, Scotland, how you doing? Get off Poland.
You've got to love those 70s fashions.
They were so glamorous, weren't they? It was beautiful. It wasn't all about sequins and celebrations, though, was it? Channel 7's telethon also entertained for very different reasons.
Here we go again. Another telethon.
That was my favourite moment in television.
Tony Bullimore. What an adventure and what a rescue.
The kiss of life. Tony Bullimore safe on board the rescue dinghy.
A race against time to rescue this effusive, almost charismatic British sailor.
They might be talking about film rights in Hollywood, but this is real life. And you could never write a script like this.
Prince Arthur threatened to kill police.
For 4 decades, the lives of ordinary South Africans were governed by apartheid.
We went to South Africa to cover the first all-race elections.
What I feel is beyond words. It is a great moment indeed.
And we just knew that the country was on the turn of something incredibly exciting.
This election is what we have been fighting for.
In a freak landslide.
Main Street of Moira.
Early this morning, a bulk carrier was on a collision course with the stricken oil tanker.
It was a serious event. I mean, the front fell off a tanker off the coast of Western Australia.
Just as the Channel 7 helicopter arrived over the stricken oil carrier,
it blew up, you know, in spectacular fashion.
Back. It's okay, it's okay.
Equally amazing was the way Rick Arden covered the event.
Rick Arden flew out to the stricken tanker on board the Bristow rescue helicopter.
Okay.
Rick was winched out of the chopper to examine the oil slick firsthand.
All you could see was me flying through the air.
We're being lowered from the rescue helicopter over the edge now to take a closer look.
You live to tell the tale? You know, a lot of people have remembered it ever since then.
I can confirm for you now, we can see more oil coming from the back of the tanker.
Princess Diana has died.
Kira is the third young woman to vanish from Claremont in just over a year.
The Claremont serial killings really put the fear through Perth.
Police fear they're hunting for a serial killer.
You know, it wasn't safe for young women on the streets. It's as simple as that.
Still, the hunt goes on for the killer of three innocent young women.
You felt some responsibility as a reporter to let women know what was going on in the streets of Perth.
And the hotel says it discourages anyone from going it alone late at night.
And to repeat the message so that people who missed the news one night might see it the next night, to not get bored of telling people it's unsafe, there's a serial killer out there.
And still the investigation goes on.
It has been a very long time.
It sure has. Now, for 41 years, telethon's been our heart and soul here at Seven, something we're very proud of, aren't we?
Justifiably so, I think. Our first telethon in 1968 raised just under $105,000. In 1980, we raised our first million. And every year since, West Australians have delivered generously.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's my pleasure on behalf of all of us here at Channel 7 to officially open Telethon.
Here we go again, another Telethon.
Was so exciting and such a community effort.
A time when people pondered some of the problems of others and considered how they might help overcome them.
It wasn't something that was artificial, it was heartfelt by a lot of people.
The establishment of Telethon, I think, is the greatest thing that's happened in television in Western Australia.
And that's what's not been lost, the true spirit of Telethon, and we must not forget that.
It's a part of the community, it'll go on forever.
It's a great 24 hours. Of television, and it's television in its purest sense. It's unscripted, you don't quite know what's going to happen.
Oh! Listen, I'm on your side.
Magic moments, wonderful moments.
Very therapeutic.
I ain't going in the mud though, no mud.
As Harry Connick, miming the words to the song with a CD playing.
Might never be cross, try to be
and people boss. In the audience actually thought I was Harry Connick.
that was Harry Connick Jr., wasn't it?
Absolutely. So? I'm questioning my own identity at this point.
But the big standout from the international stars, I suppose, was Stevie Wonder.
Alexander 48, the great 48.
And that 48 wasn't her age, I can tell you that.
And she was an absolute sensation. Peter Dean will tell you more about that.
Oh, can you say what I'm going to say? Gee, you don't get too many of those to the pound, you know.
Let's cross out for the big fight. Here's Basil.
You could see the fear in Dicko's eyes.
Gentlemen, I want a nice clean fight. It's 3 times 1 minute round.
Danny actually did give him a couple a little harder than he would have normally.
This doesn't look good at all for Dixon. He may host Celebrity Survivor, but I'm not sure he can be a Celebrity Survivor in this bout.
I give him 5 seconds.
Favourite was Sammy Davis, who was just the most delightful man.
The candy man makes everything he makes satisfying and delicious. You talk about your childhood wishes, you can even eat the dishes.
He said to me one night, he said, "Do you have a request?" I said, "Sammy, I said, I'd love you to sing Old Man River."
The whole Studio One, as jam-packed as it was as one quiet.
He just keep rolling.
That was my favourite moment in television.
I want to tell you that I'm very happy to be part and thrilled to be part of this wonderful telethon.
This is something that is important.
Do your part. With your love, give.
It is when we help that the children in your community can lead a fuller and happier life.
It's a great cause. Please give generously.
These are kids. They're sick.
Our request of you is simple. Will you help them?
It's not that unusual when everything is beautiful. It's just another
Sir James Crothers used to say telethon had two aims. One was to make people laugh and the other was to make them cry.
It's just another ordinary miracle today.
How good was that?
Wonderful.
And I think it's fair to say that telethon has made a difference to so many lives and continues to do so.
For sure. And long may it last. Well, up next, the day the Army invaded Seven.
Well, I don't care whether they're Dad's Army or not, they know something about football, and that's something that I reckon makes this show what it is.
Frank Sparrow blew a fuse. Oh.
Outrageous question.
The beauty of public affairs is that you can cover almost anything from current news to medical breakthroughs.
When the cyst was finally diagnosed, it was as big as four basketballs.
Just a madman on a farm up near Northampton.
I am ordering you to get off the bridge.
Almost unbroken career of crime.
Most people don't believe politicians.
Then a bear turned on our camerawoman.
You come back in here, mate, and I'll miss you.
Mr. Mandela, thank you for joining us on the Hinch program.
When Mandela was released was just a momentous time.
It's very difficult for myself and most other people to contemplate 27 years in prison.
The only time, I think, where I've ever felt that I've been in the presence of greatness.
Tonight on Only Human.
Why don't you want Asians moving into your house?
We're often sent out to stories, we're briefed about it, we get there and we find it's not what we thought.
Because I don't like the Asians, that's all there is.
You don't want them in your place.
They're just a mob of crooks, that's all they are.
Don't you know that there's a law against what you're doing?
All they're interested about is just to put the sign up. That's all. I've had them agents, so I haven't knocked them back.
What would... Oh, no, agents. Is that what you say, no agents?
Agents, sorry.
See you later, mate.
That's a mistake.
That quest for speed eventually cost him his life.
I'm not trying to please anyone, nor am I here to win a popularity contest, nor am I here for beauty pageant, even though I'm a good-looking woman.
Sheila Silverman, or Ma Sheila, she was called by her followers, was known for her acid tongue.
Why don't you talk across the table and try and sort out your differences like this?
I don't want to talk to an idiot. I don't talk to idiots.
That's why I'm not going on television.
If people are going to take your book seriously, don't they have to assess you and your credibility?
Yeah, Mike Willacy is one of Australia's most famous journalists. He's known for his aggressive and his direct style of journalism.
I don't understand why you're not interested in discussing the actual work I've done.
He questioned her credibility and she didn't like it.
Why not? You wrote a book called Sexual Honesty.
I think that, you know, if this is your idea of the interview, it's not mine.
And then the very next night, it happened again.
Does that affect your credibility in any way?
Sorry, but I won't be questioning my credibility. I've had it.
Didn't my publicist tell you about that? I'm not going to talk about things like that anymore, whatever it is.
The one and only Norman Gunston there. Now, sport has been an enormous part of our station's commitment to the people of Perth, and it's impossible to sum it all up in just a couple of minutes.
But we're going to try. There are so many great moments. We hope the few we've chosen for you capture the spirit of Seven's dedication to sport over the last five decades.
TVW News presents Olympic Report.
I think our first major coup for TVW 7 was sending a team to the 1960 Olympic Games.
Hello, Australia. This is Sid Donovan speaking from the green slopes of Monte Mario, overlooking the Olympic Stadium in Rome.
Sid Donovan interviewed just about every Australian Olympian.
This week we spoke with some of the favoured Australian competitors, and we can assure you that most of them are in excellent form.
All he's going to see is that jam.
Three world titles with one hand.
680 kilometres an hour.
She rounded the fifth mark, 21 seconds clear of liberty.
And that was the moment that we thought, bloody hell, Australia's going to win this. Australia too is going to win the America's Cup.
The longest winning streak in sporting history was broken. The Australians had done it.
The whole place just erupted. The place went berserk.
World Team Matilda!
And for the first time, Steve
London. The stage is set for the West Coast Eagles to run out onto the pages of history.
The pinnacle, of course, was 1992.
The Eagles are going to win their first one.
To take on the Vicks and beat the best on the land was just fantastic.
This was the moment they'd all been waiting for, and the moment Victorian footy fans had been dreading.
We really stuck it up them. You know, the arch enemy were the Victorians. The longest lap of honour of all time, because they just didn't want to go off. In the end, I think the AFL said, like, come on, you blokes, can you please leave?
I declare the Commonwealth Games open.
To introduce you to the Fremantle Dockers.
Well, you've never seen anything like it. Unbelievable.
Indicarb to Hannah, who's going to get runs out through mid-wicket.
This was a Sheffield Shield match being played at the Wacker.
Look. There.
The only vision that was available on this locked-off camera was a dog attempting to fertilise a particular area of grass in front of the members' bar.
Everybody's killing themselves laughing. The dog just kept on. Stop, start, stop, start.
You know, I have to agree with Watsy. In all these years, that's still my sporting highlight on Seven.
Is it?
Hilarious.
It really was very
shallow,
funny.
Aren't I?
Yes, very shallow, but it made me laugh too.
Good. Football, though, is at the heart of sport here on Seven, thanks to a few good blokes on a Sunday back in the 60s.
Hi, folks. Well, the footy season got off to the best start in years.
With us.
I have you watching Mickey Malthouse because we don't get paid as well as you.
Thank you and welcome back to the Footy Club.
They're just football fools.
Footy on Seven, it's been an institution.
It was absolutely compelling viewing. I mean, anyone interested in footy grew up watching Channel 7's footy show on a Sunday.
It upset Mel Brown, and Mel Brown's a clown of the upset. He's the coach. I agree on this point too.
And I remember as a kid, one particular Sunday, somebody referred to them as Dad's Army.
I'll tell you one thing, you're talking about Dad's Army, but you might get the occasion yourself to be a panellist when you're a bit grey in the hair, and then you'll know what it's like to be shot at by mugs.
Poor old Frank Sparrow blew a fuse.
Because I didn't cop that very sweet.
I'm getting in early, you know, we play tomorrow, so this is probably
right.
The last
be
time
careful.
I attend on
just
attend
be
the
careful.
And I'll never forget on the opener to one of those shows, because somebody had made this comment, they went out to the front of Channel 7 here and they dressed up in army fatigues and they were marching around like they were in the army. And I think there was bombs going off and there was explosions. And I remember as a kid thinking, this is brilliant.
I want to defend my panel. I don't care whether they're Dad's Army or not. They know something about football, and that's something that I reckon makes this show what it is.
Well, they used to get pretty hairy, I can tell you that.
But I'm not on trial.
Well, who's the other two judges?
There was...
And while we're talking about babies, congratulations on son Mark last week.
Thanks very much. Yes, we're very happy about that.
Why the name Mark?
You can't call him hand pass or kick. Boom.
Excellent.
It was a very big coup in 1986 when Dennis Cometti came across from the ABC to Channel 7. I was a kid watching. I was in high school, but I remember it was a big deal.
It's an interesting story here with Michael Cox.
Yes. Well, actually, what happened at the Wacker today? He got hit on the knees, so WA may have to play without Cox next Sunday.
Oh, that's...
I used to do segments with Sir Charles Court.
Jump in. I'd have known I was going to see you at a Warren McClemont Tower.
Yes. We had a Rolls Royce here. And of course, I commandeered that. And I'd sit in the back with Sir Charles.
I'm putting a bit of a plug for my Claremont boys down there. You know, they need something to give them that bit of verve. I'm determined they're going to win the premiership this year, and I think you could fix it for them.
He would have been a great actor. Oh, well, he was. What am I saying? He's a politician.
Footy Show.
It's that time of the night where we, well, we're not trying to embarrass him, but we're walking in on someone.
Oh, this is a shocking hand. Hang on a sec, look what I found here.
He's from Melbourne, I'm surprised.
Yeah, Mark Ross.
Sorry about that.
Live from the studios of Channel 7 Perth, throughout Western Australia, Basil's Footy Show!
Hosting Basil's Footy Show, you know, this is great because I grew up watching those guys. In many ways, they were an inspiration and just part of our folklore and part of our history. To be there doing something like they had done, but many years later, was really quite special and something I got a real kick out of.
We'll see you next week, Basil's Footy Show.
Yvette, what about Woosha's pyjamas?
He took it well, didn't he?
He did.
Sorry, Woosha.
Such a long and rich tradition of footy here on Seven.
Simon, that's right. And just last weekend, of course, a big game dedicated to one of our favourites, Chris Mainwaring. For the people of Perth, he was more than a footballer, wasn't he? He was also our friend.
The news bulletin that was the most difficult for me to read was the night that Chris Mainwaring had died.
Mainie had died. I couldn't believe it.
Just expecting him to come bouncing through the door with some gag that he wanted to crack or some story that he had to tell. He was just a wonderful fella.
He was somebody who Perth loved. He was so well loved.
A lot of people would have been feeling the same pain that we were feeling here at Channel 7.
Matey was our friend, our workmate, and such a nice guy. Oh, I miss you, Chris. That's where we leave you.
It was a coordinated attack on the twin symbols of US economic and military power.
September 11 would have to be the start of a whole new era for us, a whole new deadly era in world history.
Those planes going into those buildings, I'm sure no one will ever forget seeing that.
A second airplane, a 727, just ran into the building.
And also in between, seeing those brave New York firefighters running up to try to save anyone, knowing, just about knowing that.
Oh, my God!
There was a good chance they wouldn't come out.
You guys going back?
Yeah. It's our job.
I don't think anyone will ever forget that.
That's pretty standard form.
The winner!
There was no warning, just a massive explosion.
When Bali was attacked, that threat of terrorism came that much closer to us.
Hundreds of Australians were in the area.
It just shattered the belief that Australians were safe from terrorism.
Those inside the Sari nightclub stood little chance.
Everyone that had ever been to Bali felt that it could have been them.
Local hospitals overwhelmed as burned and badly injured survivors packed inadequate emergency rooms.
Could have been us. Could have been anybody.
I'm sorry.
This is the moment of disaster.
The Boxing Day tsunami was one of nature's devastating events.
In an instant, the tourist-packed foreshore simply disappears.
Just to see that relentless tide going down the street, carrying with it cars, buildings, timber, people.
Nothing and no one could escape the water.
And from the moment the market opened, numbers dust.
I leave office as Prime Minister of Australia. I will be Prime Minister for all Australians.
Today I say to you that the challenges we face are real.
He has to be the man that the whole world wanted to win the election.
They will not be met easily or in a short span of time. But know this, America, they will be met.
Boy, has he got a task ahead of him.
Well, 50 years is a very long time in television, but so is 25 years. And here at Seven, we have two people approaching an incredible career milestone.
Yes, Simon, Rick and Sue are considered one of the world's longest news-reading duos, bringing the news into our homes for close to a quarter of a century.
I'm standing here today in Soweto.
Here in Monte Carlo Grand Prix time.
Here at Kensington Palace.
You can see here in Jordan.
Here at Horse Guards.
Live from the town of Whittlesea.
Here I am in one of the oldest parts of Moscow.
The film festival at Cannes.
I've been everywhere, man. I've been everywhere, man. Across the deserts, bare man. I breathe the mountain air, man. I travel, I've had my share, man. I've been everywhere.
Rick, tell me, what's it like to be voted one of Perth's sexiest men?
I've been everywhere.
Rick and Sue, nearly 25 years of hairspray and newsreading. Well done.
Congratulations. That's a great effort.
Thank you.
Thank you. It's been very lucky for us. We've had a fantastic time through the golden years of television and also some of the most exciting events in world history as well.
Yeah, sure apart from the occasional embarrassing moment of just seeing
a sexiest man.
Yeah, not so sure about that. But thank you to all of our viewers for watching so long.
Well put. Well, we'll see you later in the program and we will see you after the break.
Just go back to your right touch. Just go back a bit.
Okay.
Up on that little mound.
Right?
Yeah. Up on right on top of it. That's it.
For a number of farmers... For a number of farmers, yes.
Look at your feet.
One of our best newsreaders too.
Tennis? Anyone?
Sitting out here at the Channel 7 studios in Tewett Hill.
Got through that, Sandy, without laughing at all.
Welcome to World of Football.
Mana, mana.
It's Channel 7.
Mana, mana.
The place to be.
Mana, mana.
It's Lucky 7, and 7's a very lucky number.
You'll agree. Mana, mana.
You'll get the feeling.
Mana, mana.
You'll find the way. Just try the sign, it's time to
colour your world every single day.
Oh, those lavish promotion budgets back then.
Pretty flat.
But as we all know, Seven is more than just a TV station. Earlier tonight, we heard Sir James Crothers outline his vision for Channel 7 way back in 1959.
Yes, Simon, over the years, everyone at Seven has worked to realise his vision, to create that station for the people.
Once again, Perth's skyline is about to explode in a spectacular display of light and colour.
Here's the start getting underway. Number 32, that'll be Jeff Newman.
talk about some of the crazy things we used to do. What about the Birdman Rally?
Ladies and gentlemen, Norman Gunston, and welcome to Yanchep Sun City today.
Launch themselves off, you know, with six bird feathers attached to them.
Watch out, he's flying!
It was quite big prize money, and people would make really serious efforts to win it.
But the crowds loved it. They would flock up there to Yanchep in large numbers.
Chops away! Here it goes! Oh, a bit of a tail dump.
Welcome to the 2008 RAC Channel 7 Christmas pageant with the City of Perth. Telecast right throughout Western Australia.
That first year was really exciting because the set department were building a lot of the floats and so on here.
It started off at the brand new entertainment centre. It was about 40 degrees in the shade.
Well, it's Percy the Penguin and his igloo, which we all hope doesn't melt today because it's very hot.
Nobody was really sure how it would work, whether the people of Perth would come.
Since its inception in 1972, the pageant has been seen by over 2 million people.
The crowds were 7-8 deep everywhere.
Time flies when you're having fun, but for 37 years, Father Christmas has travelled from the North Pole to appear in our parade.
It was wonderful for the people of Perth. It was something that was just for them.
This was the first commercial channel in Perth, and it was supported by everybody, supported by the sponsors, supported by the viewers, and everybody enjoyed being part of Channel 7.
There was always a great sense of community, both within the building and the sense of the wider Western Australian community, centred on this place. And I think that's what was one of the things that made it not so much a job as a way of life.
I didn't realise how much it meant to people. One day a man rang up and said to me that his son was leaving the next day to go to Vietnam, and would I please wink with the other eye to wish him luck? And I still go goosebumps when I think of that, because I don't know what happened to that man or to his son.
People will never forget Channel 7.
They captured the imagination of the people of Perth.
People really invited us into their home every night, and we became part of their family.
There was a very concerted effort by Sir James especially to go out into the community.
Nobody has ever reached the public like Channel 7, and that's why they're so dominant today. It sounds like a commercial, doesn't it? But it's true.
He created a station that everybody felt was a part of the community, and it was just a lovely feeling.
Channel 7 really was a part of people's lives. They appreciated it, and we appreciated them.
It is all about 7 tonight.
And stay with us for a big farewell.
Tonight we have seen a mere snapshot of Channel 7's first half century, but isn't it always the case? So many stories to tell and so little time to tell them.
Yes, Simon, and to sign off our first fabulous 50 years from everyone here at Channel 7, thank you.
Thank you, bye-bye.
We're setting the Perth on show for the world to see. Yeah, she's the city we love, she's the best in the world, and there's no place we'd rather be. Love you, Perth. Yes, you mean the world to me. Struggle or try, there's no place we'd rather be.
I'd like to personally donate 100,000 to the telethon for the kids.
TVW Channel 7, the oldest television station so far in Western Australia.
Hope you enjoyed our story and meeting the men and women who made television in Western Australia possible. You'll see their work in the future. We hope you enjoy it. In the meantime, best wishes from TVW Channel 7 in Perth, Western Australia.